मॉर्निंग माय डियर्स, हाउ आर यू ऑल? आई होप यू ऑल आर फाइन। सो टुडे दिस वीडियो वी आर गोइंग टू बी डिस्कस अबाउट टर्म ऑन क्वेश्चन फुल्ली रिवीजन। ओके, टर्म ऑन क्वेश्चन फुल्ली रिवीजन, वेरी सून यू आर गोइंग टू बी राइट टर्म ऑन क्वेश्चन, सॉरी टर्म ऑन एग्जाम। सो हाउ मेनी मार्क्स यू आर गोइंग टू बी राइट टर्म ऑन एग्जाम मींस 50 मार्क्स। ओके, in regular time, normal days, you are writing term on exam for 80 marks. Because of COVID-19, you are not able to conduct the regular class in school. That's why we reduce the mark. So 50 marks you are going to be write term on exam. Okay. So particularly in SS, what are the lessons you are going to be read for term on means? Totally, we have 6 lessons. Okay, totally for 6 lessons for your term on exam. Okay, so how many lessons you have to read for term on exam means 6 lessons you have to read. So history, geography and SPL. So in history, second lesson, new kings and kingdom, and fourth lesson, the Mughals. Okay, so only these 2 lessons only you have to read. Okay, we completed 4 lessons in history, but you are taking only this 2 lesson only for exam. Okay, so for term 1, history, new kings and kingdom and Mughals. Okay, so geography also we complete 4 lessons, but out of that 4, 2 lessons only, 2 important lessons only we are taking. So second lesson, inside our earth, and fourth lesson, air. Okay, inside our earth and air, and then SPL. So SPL also we completed 4 lessons. Okay, so in that 4 we are taking 2 lessons. So second lesson, role of the government in health. Okay, role of the government in health and how the state government work. Okay, so and how the state government work. So this 6 lessons alone you want to read thoroughly for the exam. Okay, so the question paper somewhat difficult, which I said up to this. So you have to read each and every line of these 4-6 lessons. That time only you can able to answer the question which we asked in exam, right? So next you are going to revise history second lesson, new kings and kingdoms. Okay, new kings and kingdoms. Already I taught this lesson very elaborate manner. This is a revision session. So I just overall give the revision. Okay. So in this lesson, how many topics we discuss means around 5 to 6 topic. Okay, 5 to 6 are main topic. In that we will discuss lot. Okay. So in that lesson, the first is the emergency of new dynasty. Okay, the emergency of new dynasties, particularly the time of 7th to 14th century. Okay, 7th to 14th century, how a new dynasties were emerged, that only we discuss. Okay, so in the topic we discuss about Samantas. Okay, Samantas, who are Samantas? In grade 6 also we discuss Samantha is a shift time, who are the in charge of maintain the army and to collect the revenue of particular area. Okay, they were appointed by the king. Okay, so like that Samantas, one particular period they started to declare themselves as a king. Okay, so how they declare, why they declare means, maybe in that time, in that region, the king, the king's power going to be weakened. Okay, so that's why in that places the kings were declared themselves as a king. Okay, so best example, Rashtrakuda. Okay, Rashtrakuda, where it was located means present day Karnataka. Okay, so in earlier, before emerge of Rashtrakuda, this was under the control of Chalukya. Okay, this was under the control of Chalukya kingdom. When the Chalukya kings going to be weakened, they are not good at ruling that time, that Rashtrakuda, the founders of Rashtrakuda, they declare, they are workers, the Rashtrakuda people, they work as a subordinate of Chalukya. Okay, they are the subordinate of Chalukya, particularly person Dandidurga. Okay, Dandidurga, he was work as a Samanta, as a subordinate of Chalukya. So when the Chalukya king was weakened, he declared himself as a king of his region. Okay, which region he was work as a Samanta? So in that region, he declared himself. himself as a saman king. So for declaring king, he conduct one yaha Hiranya Garbha. Okay, he conduct one yaha Hiranya Garbha. Okay, so like that the Rashtrakuta dynasties were emerged. So same like Gujaran Pratikar also. Okay, Gujaran Pratikar also one of the person Mayurishaman. Okay, he was Brahmin. So he declared himself as a king. So through some ritual sacrifice. Okay, so like that many new dynasties were emerged in that period. Okay, which period means 7th to during 7th to 14th century. Okay, during 7th to 14th century, many new dynasties were emerged. Okay, so next, how the kingdoms they did their administration. Okay, suppose in this lesson when we are going to be discuss about Cholas, same like the Gujarat, Pratikara, Rashtrakuta. So a king wants to rule the country means he have to do very good administration, right? So what are the methodology the kings were followed for a very good administration means they follow various method. Okay, so one of the method, the rulers shared their power. Okay, the rulers shared their powers with the samantas. Okay, so why? Because the king always in capital city. So suppose some distant area of the kingdom wants to maintain a very good person. Okay, so he may very powerful, he may very knowledgeable, and he may very skillful person. Okay, so the king going to be designed. Okay, he was very good person, and he is able to maintain that area like that. He designed and he shared his power to that person. Okay, that person's when we called as samantas. Okay, and then they had a relation with the peasant. Okay, peasant means farmers. Okay, so farmers, traders, and Brahmins. So all together they join and they are doing administration work. Maybe they are appointed as large peasant, they are large landowners, may appoint to collect revenue on particular area. The traders are very big traders, high position traders, they have some rights to maintain that particular area. Like that, the king separates his power. Okay, present now how our central government and state government works. It's divide our country into many districts, many taluks, many panchayat. Like that, in those days also they divide and they are maintaining the country. Okay, so in this page we have the mentioning box 400 type of tax which was collected by Chola dynasties, that was called as Vetti. Okay, so that and all they mention in our book. Okay, so administration in the kingdom. So next topic, Prasasti and land grants. Okay, Prasasti and land grants. Okay, so Prasasti means last year itself we studied the price of the king. Okay, so when some court poet or some educated person, he want to receive gift from king, he is writing good quality of the king. Okay, so the price of the king is called as Prasasti. Okay, so suppose before starting the king name, we have very big lengthy introduction to Raja Di Raja, Raja Gambira, Raja Kulotunga, like that lengthy introduction comes under Prasasti. Okay, so which person write this, like poet, or which person he described the king this like, he may get land grants from the king. Okay, so for a gift, so that is human mentality. When the person was prized by other person, he is ready to give some gift for pricing. Okay, so like that, the kings give the lands to the to like that persons say a manner of land grants. Okay, in Chola dynasties, like that many land grants did by the Chola king. That we discuss later. So That land grants were mentioned in temple inscription or some special copper plate. Okay, that too gave given in our book in box. Okay, copper plate. In that copper plate, they mentioned this land was granted by this particular king to the particular person for this reason. Like this, they give. Okay, so emergency of new dynasty, administration of kingdom, and prasasti and land rights. Right? Okay, warfare, wealth. So for what reason the kings were fought each other? Okay, for what reason the kings were fight each other? That only we are going to discuss for this topic. Okay, so for under this topic we discuss about four matters, four important events. Okay, one is tripartite struggle. Okay, so tripartite struggle, three ruling people. Okay, three ruling people: Gujarat Pratikara, Rashtrakuta, and Pala dynasty. Okay, Gujarat Pratikara, Rashtrakuta, and Pala dynasties often fight each other. These three kingdoms, these three kings often fight each other to capture the area of Kannauj. Okay, to capture the area of Kannauj. Why? Because where Kannauj is located means it is located in present in Uttar Pradesh. It is a very fertile area. Okay, this is very good for agriculture activity, very wealthy area. Okay, so to capture this region, these three dynasties, Gujarat Pratikara, Rashtrakuta, and Pala dynasties often fight each other. Okay, this event one we called as tripartite struggle. Okay, this is one we called as tripartite struggle. So to control one area, the kings were fought each other. Okay, next we discuss about Sultan Muhammad of Ghajini. Ghajini is the country. Ghajini is the ruling area of Muhammad, which it was where it is located, means present day Afghanistan. Okay, so this ruler around 13 times he invaded India. Okay, he comes to India and he looted many things. Okay, he looted. What do you mean by looted? Capture many things from here to his country. Okay, he is not aiming to rule India, but he is taking what was his focus means, particularly temples and the king's palace. Okay, wherever he can be able to get lot of gold and precious stones, he focused that place. Okay, so around 13 times he comes to India. Each and every time he captured lot of things from here to his country. Okay, so one of his last invasion is Somnath temple. Somnath temple, where it was located, means present in Gujarat. Okay, so which was famous temple. He looted many things. Okay, lot of gold and silver and precious stones from there to his country. Okay, so after Muhammad Ghajini, after some times Muhammad Ghori. Okay, so Muhammad Ghori, Muhammad his name, Ghori is this ruling area. So he also ruled in nearby Ghajini region. Okay, so he came. He had the aim to rule India. Okay, Muhammad Ghajini not have any aim to rule India, but he had the ambition to rule India. So he comes to India in the year of 1191. Okay, year of 1191. He met the Rajput rulers. Okay, the group of Rajput rulers, when he started to come to India, when Muhammad Ghori comes to India, that time in North India was ruled by many Rajput rulers. Okay, small rulers they ruled. So they are joining together and they protest, they war against Ghori. Okay, that's why in the 1191 war, in that war, Muhammad Ghori is last. Okay, he was defeated by Rajput kings. Okay, so defeated by Rajput kings, that's why he returned back to his country. Okay, he returned back to his country. So one of the Rajput king, Prithviraj Chauhan, he only lead the war in 1191. Okay, but immediately in 1192 again the Muhammad Ghori comes to India to capture the region, Delhi and Ajmer region. That time the Rajput kings, I already said, no, the Rajput king, they are made agreement, they are joined together and they fight against Ghori, I said no. But the time of 1192, Okay, so this is one of the main reason after Muhammad Ghori Vandi, many Muslim rulers they started to rule. Okay, so because of our Hindu kings not unit, that's why we lost our country to other country rulers. Okay, so these three events they mentioned in this topic, war for wealth. This is very important topic. All of the events, okay, in your book, page number 21, is very very important. So you have to know everything. Okay, so in this topic you have lot of questions. Okay, lot of 1 mark, 2 mark, or 3 mark, 5 mark questions are in this page. So you are supposed to read thoroughly in this page, right? Closer look. Refer in your book page number 22. Okay, refer in your book page number 22 about Cholas. Okay, Cholas you know very well. The best ruler of South India. Okay, the best ever ruler of South India is called as Cholas. Okay, so in this topic we are going to discuss about five subtopics. Okay, so how the Cholas started to rule? We can already say the Chola dynasties were divided into two. Okay, one is yearly Chola, another is later Chola. Okay, so we are going to discuss here about later Chola alone. Okay, here we are going to discuss about later Chola alone. So later Chola, who was the founder of later Chola means Vijayalaya Chola. Okay, who was the founder of later Chola means Vijayalaya Chola. Okay, from Uttirayar he captured the Kaveri Delta region. Okay, he captured particularly nearby Urayur we have. So in that region was captured by Vijayalaya Chola. Okay, when he captured, then he shifted his capital. Okay, see, yearly Chola's capital was Urayur alone. Okay, yearly Chola's capital Urayur alone. For administration purpose, Vijayalaya Chola shifted his capital from Urayur to Tanjore. Okay, shifted his capital from Urayur to Tanjore. So in this capital, Vijayalaya Chola built a lot of palaces, and he built one of the goddess temple, Nisimbasundari. Okay, one of the goddess temple, Nisimbasundari. Okay, so after Vijayalaya Chola, many Chola rulers they came and they started to rule in Tanjore. Okay, so next is the rulers of Cholas, they give lot of things for constructing temples and bronze sculptures. Okay, constructing temple and bronze sculptures, particularly Rajaraja I and Rajendra Chola I. Okay, Rajaraja I and his son Rajendra Chola I, they gave lot of things, they did lot of things for constructing temple. Okay, they are constructing very very big temples, particularly in Tanjore and Gangaikonda Cholapuram. They are constructing very big temple. In the temple, it's a place, they are hub of people. Okay, it's their main reason to develop their country. Okay, so around the temple, many people they started to settle. So many business developed in around the temple. Okay, so the temples were very very important reason for developing the country's economy. Okay, and the bronze sculptures. Okay, bronze sculpture, one of the unique feature of Cholas. Okay, even nowadays also Cholas bronze sculptures alone, it's very costly in the world. Okay, so they are following a very unique method of making bronze from copper and tin. They are mixture a particular proportion, and they are making sculptures. Okay, so whenever they construct temple, in that temple and all, they are keeping many statues, bronze statues and sculptures. Okay, that's why they are very popular even nowadays also. Okay, so and then the Cholas not only give important for constructing temples and bronze sculptures, they also give important particularly agriculture and irrigation. Okay, so basically South India was agriculture based country one. No? Even those days, in the time of Chola ruling, the Endagiri, Trichy and Tanjore area were called as situated here. Okay, so the Cholas, they are maintaining, they are donating lot of amount for maintain pond, lake and river banks. Okay, even for irrigation there are many branches from Kaveri river, they are constructing many branches of the river. Okay, particularly in that area of Pudukottai and Nagapattinam area and all, they develop lot of canals. Okay, from the main river they are making lot of canals. For maintaining that, they are appointing a special person, and particularly for maintaining the embankment means the compound, that suppose this is the river, means suppose this is the river, so the two side of river we have some height compound, like we have that one we called as the embankment. For maintaining that embankment also they appoint a special people. Okay, so they give salary and they are maintaining. Suppose anyone waste the water, they are punished severely in Chola dynasty. Okay, so agriculture and irrigation is the main income of Cholas, right? Administration method of Chola dynastics means how they administrate, how they separation for administration the ruling area, means they separate into four. One is Oor, Nadu, Naharam and Sabha. Okay, Oor, Nadu, Naharam and Sabha. Okay, so Oor means settlements of peasant. Okay, like village. Okay, settlement of peasants were called as Oor in those days. Okay, settlement of peasants is called as Oor. Okay, next is Nadu. So group of large villages. Okay, group of these settlements, is a group of this Oor formed in a large unit. Okay, group of, suppose we have one village here, so that particular village is were called as Oor in those days. So suppose nearby 10 to 50 villages, means they joined together, they joined one unit, that is called as Nadu. Okay, group of large villages formed a large unit is called as Nadu. Okay, next is Naharams. Okay, Nahara means the association of traders. Okay, so in Chola dynastics, a variety of traders they are led. Okay, so they make association, they are making association with the help of that association, they are doing trading. Okay, so that association were called as Naharams. Okay, next is Sabha. Okay, Sabha means the assembly of Brahmins. Okay, the assembly of Brahmins were called as Sabha. So each one plays important role for administration. Okay, so in Oor we have some head of that Oor, so he only the responsible, he only the person responsible for the government to maintain that village, that particular place, in a peaceful and silent. Okay, and Nadu same like they, these members only they are going to take their queries to government. Okay, so each one there plays very important role for administration of that country. Okay, administration of Chola dynastics, right? So different types of land which was divided in the Chola dynastics. Okay, so in Chola dynastics they were divided the land into five category. Okay, one is Velan Vahai, Brahmodaya, Salaboha, Devadana and Palli Chanda. Okay, Velan Vahai, Brahmodaya, Salaboha, Devadana and Palli Chanda. Okay, so Devadana. So Devadana land is belongs to normal farmers, normal peasant. So that's why the Velan Vahai, the land of non-Brahmana peasant. Okay, non-Brahmana peasant means belongs to non-Brahman. Okay, they are not Brahman, that their land were called as Velan Vahai. Okay, the entire land will be for agriculture activity only. Okay, next is Brahmodaya. Okay, next is Brahmodaya. So the land is gifted to Brahmins. Okay, the land gifted to Brahmins is called as Brahmodaya. This land, for what are the things they cultivate in this land, there is no tax free land. Okay, so Salaboha. Okay, Salaboha, so this is the land for maintenance of school. In this land of maintenance of school, suppose who are educate the people. Okay, some in those days under that Gurukula method alone, there is no separate like nowadays like that schools. So the people, the person who voluntarily educate the other people, for them the government donate the land. for maintaining the temple. The persons, they need money. So for that, they gifted the land to temple. So from that land, they are cultivating something. They sell that things. From that, they earning money. Okay, so that land is called as Devadana. So which land is gifted to temple is called as Devadana. Next is Pallichandam. Okay, Pallichandam. How the Hinduism was very famous in the time of Chola dynasties. The same like Jainism and Buddhism also very popular. Okay, so for that reason, some land were donated to the Jaina institution. Okay, Jaina institution. Why? Because they are the Jain people. They are very well versed in curing some diseases. Okay, they are making some hospital like structure. So for that, for increase that activity, the government, the kings, they donate the land to Jaina institution that were called as Pallichandam. Okay, once again I read, Velan Vagai, Velan Vagai, the land of non Brahman patient. Brahmodaya, the land gifted to Brahmins. Sala Boha, the land for maintenance of schools. And then Devadana, the land gifted to temples. And Pallichandam, the land donated to Jaina institution. This is also very important. You are supposed to know everything, all five, without any mistake. Right? Sabha means the association, the assembly of Brahmana, we discussed before one. Okay, Sabha is assembly of Brahmana. Okay, so who want to become the member of Sabha? Okay, in Sabha they appoint some members. Okay, so who are the eligible to stand in election to become the Sabha members? Means a set of rules and regulations they are given in the Uttarameru inscription. Okay, so in Uttarameru nearby, as it was in Kanjipuram district, in that inscription they mentioned clearly who are the eligible candidate to become a Sabha member. Okay, so what are the priority? What are the eligibility should need a person? Means they must have owned land. Okay, he must need owned land with revenue. Okay, from that land the revenue should be collected. Okay, and then they have to own their own house. Okay, they have to possess their own house. Okay, without house there is no own. Individual house means they are not qualified. And the age, what is the age limit? Means 35 to 70. So one who want to become the Sabha member, he must complete the age of 35 or is not exceed the age of 70. Okay, and then he must well versed in Veda, hearing Yajur Sama Adarvana. So he must well versed in Veda. Why? Because already I said Sabha is a assembly of Brahmins. So a Brahmin, he must well versed in Veda. Okay, and next one is very important. He should have some knowledge of administration. Without administration knowledge, is not able to maintain. Okay, so and he must honest. Okay, he must honest. And then one more point they gave in our book. So if anyone of his family, and before itself they are a member of Sabha, means within 3 hours, when he was a member of Sabha, suppose his father or his brother was a member of Sabha, means after 3 years in that family no one is allowed to stand in election. Okay, so like that a set of rules and regulations were assigned by the people to stand in Sabha election. Right? Here when we discuss about the Mughals, the history fourth lesson. Okay, so Mughals, who are Mughals? So Mughals is the people who have come from present day Afghanistan. They ruled India around 200 years. Okay, so here I mentioned two ancestors of Mughals. Okay, so from their mother's side, see who was the first Mughal ruler, who was the founder of Mughal ruler in India, means Babur. Okay, so Babur would be the founder of India, sorry, founder of Mughal ruler in India. So there were descendants of two great lines. Okay, Mongol. Where is Mongolia located? Means present day south of Russia. Above the Afghanistan in Russia. Suppose you have atlas in your house, means you have to refer. Okay, so who was the Genghis Khan? Is it tribes? He was the ruler of Mongolia. He captured lot of area. Okay, Mongolia, Pakistan, Afghanistan, many region he captured. He ruled. Okay, so from mother side he only their ancestors. Okay, from their father side. Okay, from their father side, Babur's father side, the Timur. Timur is their ancestor. Okay, who was Timur? Means he was the ruler of present day Iran, Iraq, and Turkey. Okay, so he was the ruler of Iran, Iraq, and present day Turkey. So Timur and Genghis Khan. So their ancestors were Mughals' ancestors were Timur and Genghis Khan. Okay, from them all the entire Mughal dynasty came. So even the Mughal kings, who were the famous Mughal kings, they are not willing to describe them as a Mongols. They are very supported. They are very believed Timur alone. But by mistake, by false in histories, in history, all the historians refer the kings of Babur, Akbar, Humayun, Jahangir, Shah Jahan, and Aurangzeb, everybody under the name of Mughals. Sorry, Mughals only. Why? Because they are coming from Mongolia. Like that only they explain. But very true, very frank, they are not willing to describe them as a Mongols. Why? Because they love Timur alone. Why? Because he was very enthusiasm. He was very, very capability for ruling. Was somewhat developed. That's why they are proud to say we are the successor of Timur like that. Okay. Famous Mughal rulers. Okay. The famous Mughal rulers. Here I mentioned some names, some kings' names. So Babur, Humayun, Akbar, Jahangir, Shah Jahan, and Aurangzeb. Okay, Babur, Humayun, Akbar, Shah Jahan. Sorry, Jahangir, Shah Jahan, and Aurangzeb. Okay, so Babur only the founder of Mughal dynasty. Okay, Babur only the founder of Mughal dynasty. So when the age of 9 itself, Babur became the king in the area of Ferghana, as it's already we discussed. Okay, Ferghana, where it is, where it was located, means present day Afghanistan. Okay, so later he is not able to continue to rule that his country. So he was captured the area of Kabul. Okay, so around 15 to 20 years he ruled in Kabul. So from there only he comes to know about India. Okay, so he eagerly noticed India for ruling purpose. So that time he get advice, so he get letter from Indian kings. So he taking his army, his soldiers, and in the place of Panipat, a war happened between Lodi, okay, Ibrahim Lodi and Babur, there of 1526. So in that war, Babur was born. Even Babur had very small army. In the opposite side, Ibrahim Lodi's side is very big army, but he was defeated, Ibrahim Lodi, because he had latest weapons like cannon and gunpowder, everything Babur had. That's why he won the war very quickly. Okay, so like that only Babur founded his ruling India. Okay, that's why Babur was called as father of Mughal dynasties in India. Okay, so how long he was ruled, means only 4 years. Okay, Babur ruled India only 4 years. So after the death of Babur, his son Humayun became the king of Mughal dynasties. Okay, Humayun is the elder son of Babur. So he was very good. He proved his talent in the war of Panipat. So he was very powerful warrior. He was literate. He was educated. But when Babur was dying that time, he get promised to Humayun to treat all his brother in a positive way. Okay, so Humayun had three brothers. Already I said Hindar, Askari, and Khurram. Like three brothers he had. So all these three brothers are not support Humayun. Okay, so first 1530 to 1540. So this first 10 years he had lot of problem among his brothers. Okay, he is not take any serious step among their brother. Okay, so that's why in the year of 1540, one of the small sultan, small ruler, he was ruled in Bihar. His name was Sher Khan. His name was Sher Khan. Okay, his name was Sher Khan. He captured Delhi and Agra in the year of 1540. Okay, Sher Khan captured the area Delhi and Agra in the year of 1540. So Humayun escaped from Delhi to Afghan, and at last he reached Iran. Okay, present day Iran, and he get help from that king in the year of 1555. Okay, so 1555, Sher Khan was tried. That time Humayun again returned back to Delhi and he started to rule. Okay, but he ruled only 1 year after 1555. So 1556 he was died. So in between 15 years was ruled Delhi and Agra area ruled by Sher Khan. He used the method. What method he used means that administration method is very excellent manner. So after Humayun, who became the king of Mughal dynasty, means Akbar. Akbar followed entire administration which was followed by Sher Khan. Okay, which was implemented, which was started and implemented by Sher Khan. That alone Akbar followed during his ruling time. Okay, so Akbar ruled Mughal dynasty into 49 years. Okay, Akbar ruled Mughal dynasty into 49 years. We can divide the Akbar ruling into three period. Okay, three period. So one is when he was under the control of his guide Mr. I forgot his name. Wait once again. So he was under the control of Mr. Bairam Khan. Okay, he was the domestic staff. Sorry, he was the he was the guide of Akbar, Bairam Khan. So under the control, Akbar was ruled the Delhi and surrounding area in beginning stage. After he realized, okay, when Akbar became the king means at the age of 30, okay, when he was 30, that time itself he became the king of Mughal dynasty. Okay, so first 5 to 6 years the domination of Bairam Khan is more in this region, and then one of the domestic staff, her name was Mahamanga. Okay, he was the stepmother of Akbar, so she also dominated. Okay, so like that many domination happened in the beginning first 10 years. Later he was ruled very successful. What are the administration method or what are the relaxation given for Akbar is very good. When he became the king, that time itself he realized India is a country of Hindus. Okay, so Akbar was a Muslim. So when a Muslim king wants to rule this like multicultural country, he wants to adjust that culture. Okay, we should not, he believed, I should not force the people to follow any one particular religion or any one culture. Like that, he was very clear. So he was very flexible to the people. That's why he came able to rule a very successful manner. That's why he also was ruled 49 years. Okay, when he was ruled that time, he attempted a lot of war, okay, to expand his country. So each and every end of the war, he did somewhat extraordinary method. He used some extraordinary method, particularly to Rajput. He married the Rajput, many Rajput princes. Okay, so a peaceful agreement, marriage agreement. That's why many Rajput kings, they are voluntarily support Akbar. Okay, that's why he expanded his ruling area to India. Okay, so after Akbar death, who was became the king means Akbar's elder son Jahangir. Okay, Akbar's son Jahangir. So before Jahangir, before the king of Mughal dynasty, Jahangir was called as Salim. Okay, so what is his name? Natural name means Salim. When he became the king, he was called as Jahangir. Okay, so Jahangir, he ruled around interpret the ruling. Okay, why means in those days the ladies not allowed rule the country, but indirectly the time of Jahangir ruling, indirectly Noor Jahan rule was very important. In your book also they gave, she printed a coin with her face like that, they gave information, right? So after Jahangir, his son Shah Jahan became the king. Okay, after Jahangir, his son Shah Jahan became the king. So he also ruled around 30 years. Okay, around 31 years he ruled. In his period, he gave more importance for architect. Okay, for he constructed lot of buildings, lot of painting. So he gave the craft and the art and craft is more important. Okay, so his period only Red Fort was built, Taj Mahal was built, many monuments and many particularly that throne, peacock throne was built in his period alone. Okay, so he was very luxury king. Okay, so he had three sons. I think so. His elder son was Tarakos, second son was Aurangzeb, third son one son he had. Okay, so out of this three sons, after Jahangir, Aurangzeb became the king. How Aurangzeb became the king means he was very good warrior. Okay, Tarakos, he only the elder son. See, before that, whenever we studied in 6th standard, who was become the in a dynasty, who became the king means one king was died, his elder son only became the king. Here Babar elder son Humayun, Humayun's elder son Akbar's elder son Jahangir elder son Shah Jahan. So like that order they follow. But Aurangzeb is not ready to allow his elder brother to rule country. Why? Because Tarakos always in court, he is not enter any war field. He is very good poet. He don't know how to fight to enemies. That's why Aurangzeb, he was always in war field. That's why Aurangzeb felt Tarakos is not a person to rule a country. I am only the good for rule the country in a very successful manner. Like that he thought. That's why he put his father Aurangzeb, put Shah Jahan into jail. Okay, Shah Jahan was not died in the year of 1658. After 4 to 5 years only he was died. So Aurangzeb arrested Shah Jahan and put him in a house jail. Okay, house arrest. Okay, so then he became the king in the year of 1658. So around 49 years. How Akbar ruled like that? He also ruled 49 years. Okay, 49 years was ruled. But this 49 years he faced lot of problems. Why? Because the ruling area was expanded from Afghanistan, sorry, from Pakistan to here West Bengal, present day West Bengal, Bangladesh, up to that they ruled. And then here in west direction, Gujarat, Karnataka, Maharashtra, that entire Telangana, a part of Tamil Nadu, so they ruled. So the ruling area was very broad. So for suppose he controlled any problem in one region, suppose there a rebellion happened in Bengal, so he went Bengal and he controlled the rebellion or revolt. Again one more problem happened in created in Hyderabad. Okay, suppose he cleared that, again one more problem happened in Gujarat. So like that many collaborations, many problems happened Aurangzeb ruling time. See, he was very strict personality. Okay, he is not flexible. Suppose anybody else involved corruption, they are punished severely. Okay, so the beginning year that administration was followed, which was followed by Aurangzeb, was excellent. But the end of his period, okay, end of last 10 years, who are involved in administration, they are involved in lot of corruption. Okay, so the Nawabs and the local administration, they are involved in corruptions. That's why after death of Aurangzeb, the Mughal dynasty is going to be splintered into many small ruling area. That and all we will discuss in 10th lesson, okay, in your last lesson. So for this, you are supposed to know the time, the year, how many, from what year to up to which year they ruled. Babur means 1526 to 1530. Humayun means 1530 to 1540 and 55 to 56. Akbar means 1556 to 1605. Jahangir 1605 to 1615. 1627. Shahjahan 1627 to 1658. Aurangzeb 1658 to 1707. So the year you should be remember clearly, right? Say how the Mughal kings maintained their relations with the other rulers means particularly up to Jahangir, up to time of Jahangir and Shahjahan period, they had the policy of marriage. Okay, so suppose one area, one Rajput area was captured by Mughal kings means the king or their family members ready to marriage the Hindu princes. Okay, so like that they follow the methodology of expand their ruling and to maintain the relation with the other kings. Even some Rajput kings, Rajput families, they voluntarily ready to give their family girls to Mughal royal family the marriage contract. Okay, so then one more method, Vadan Jagir. Okay, Vadan Jagir they follow. What do you mean by Vadan Jagir means, suppose one area was captured by Mughal ruler. Okay, particularly a best example, Sisodoya, it's a ruling, it's a Rajput ruling area. So that was captured by Akbar in the war. But after capturing the Akbar, ready to give that land particular king. Okay, suppose one person working as a king or ruling that area, after capturing that land again given to them and they asked to rule that area with a peaceful manner, and yearly they have to pay a certain amount to Mughal king. Okay, so their rights and duties will not stop by the king, but instead they have to pay that land particular amount to Mughal government. Okay, so that relation also followed, that only called as Vadan Jagir. And that some administration method, how they separate the country means they appoint some person as a mansabdar. Okay, they appoint some person as a mansabdar, like Samantha we discussed now, like that only. So he allotted some land, he may allotted some land, some amount of soldiers. So he have to maintain that soldiers, he have to maintain that army, and he can collect tax from that land. Okay, so like that mansabdars were appointed. How their qualification were assist means jat, the method of jat. Okay, the jat means ranking system of mansabdar. Okay, so highest ranking system was 5000 in the time of Mughal's rule. Okay, so who has the highest rank means he received lot of amount from the government. Okay, so what he received from his salary, that is called as jagir. So what mansabdar receives salary from the government is called as jagir. So mansabdar like samanta, so his qualification is measured as a jat. Okay, what he received as his salary is called as jagir. Okay, and then one more method they followed, particularly in rural area. Okay, so that is, see that mansabdari jat is followed in fortification or garrison town. Okay, already we discussed garrison town and all. Okay, in village side they appointed jamindars. Okay, in village side they appointed jamindar to collect revenue. Okay, so the particular village, set of village they allotted to jamindar to collect revenue. So that revenue were called as jat. Okay, that revenue were called, which was they collected from the normal people, that was called as jat. So after the collecting, they have to pay to what they collect, they have to submit to government. So for that they receive some salary from the government. So who was a very famous minister of Akbar period means Todarmal. Okay, so Todarmal was the famous minister of Akbar period. He was the minister of revenue. Okay, he was the Akbar's revenue minister. Who means Todarmal? He only implement this like method of tax collecting. Okay, so tax is very important for a country development. It's a backbone, economic backbone. It's a revenue tax alone that was collected in the time of Akbar period, very good. But the time of Aurangzeb period, it was collapsed because of the people who involved in charge of revenue system. They are involved corruption. That's why the entire economy will collapse the time of Aurangzeb ruling time. How the Mughal Empire going to be declines in the time of the salary to the people is very less compared to Aurangzeb period. Okay, so already I said Man Sabdar is a person who receives salary from the government according to their rank, according to their jot, they receive salary. Okay, so the number of people the time of Akbar it's very less, but in the time of Shah Jahan and Aurangzeb period, the Man Sabdar count is very large. Suppose they collect tax from the people around 1 lakh, means out of that 1 lakh, around 60 to 80 thousand spent to the salary of Man Sabdar. Okay, so rest of 40,000 only they have to able to spend to military and people development. So that's why so the maximum amount were sent. For the salary to the people, salary to the Man Sabdar. So that is very important reason the falling down of economy of the Mughal dynasties. Okay, and then poverty. The people who lived in village they faced lot of poverty in the time of Aurangzeb period. Okay, so what they earn that is enough for only hand to hand. There is nothing for savings. So that also one of the reason for economic failure. And the time of end of 17th century, the Aurangzeb lasted 10 years. Many Nawabs, many governors, they declared themselves as an independent ruler of the particular region, particularly Awadh, Bengal and Hyderabad and all. That Nawabs were declared themselves as independent ruler. So that's why the Mughal dynasty going to be split into small ruling area. Okay, that under already I said 10th lesson we will discuss elaborate manner. Okay, so up to now we discussed 2 lesson, new kings and kingdoms and the Mughal dynasties. Okay, so for your exam this 2 lesson alone you have to prepare this 2 lesson each and every line. That time only you can able to write answer in correct manner, right? So thank you, all the best, have a nice day.